It's a pleasure to be out here. I spent a lot of time in Fairfax County working on this book. I made the decision early on to sort of set this story in Fairfax County for reasons that all of you, I'm sure, can understand and that I'll get into in a little bit. Actually, one of the reasons that I set it here is because I live in Arlington and I wanted to make sure that I wrote a book that was close to me so that I could actually commute to do all my interviews and so forth. It would have been much more difficult for me to set this book in Southern California or something like that, even though it would have made just as much sense or New York or something like that. But, you know, Fairfax County turned out to be an ideal place to do the research. And when I settled on it, one of the very first people that I came to seek advice from was Professor Witte, because the Institute for Immigration Research is sort of one of its kind in America and doing very important work. And so I laud you for that. And Jim set me straight right from the start, gave me a lot of good ideas that I ran with. So just to give you a little bit of an overview of my book, first of all, I see it as a story of a test of America's identity and the myth that has surrounded, the myth that was present at the founding of America about its identity. You know, George Washington in 1782 gave a speech in New York to a group of immigrants in which he said, "The bosom of America is open to receive not only the opulent and respectable stranger, but the oppressed and persecuted of all nations and religions." That was 1782. So with that, he sort of set out this idea that we have always had throughout our history of what America offered the world, this land that was open to everybody, a nation of opportunity, where anyone could excel and achieve and attain higher status without regard to their color, race, religion, whatever. So that was the ideal. It was the myth, in fact. And the reality was evident just 10 years later, 1792, when the U.S. Congress passed first immigration bill in the history of the United States and limited U.S. citizenship to free white persons. So that was the reality. And this kind of contrast between the ideal or the myth and the reality persisted, in my judgment, for close to 200 years, all the way up till 1965 with the passage of the 1965 Immigration Act. Because you saw this citizenship. Obviously, we had African Americans enslaved. We had a immigration law that restricted citizenship to free white persons. The title of my book, A Nation of Nations, comes actually from a Walt Whitman poem, actually prose. It was the preface to Leaves of Grass, in which he wrote that the United States is not merely a nation, but a teeming nation of nations. So Walt Whitman bought into this myth, you know, and wrote this like beautiful sort of prose passage about what America promised. I'm sure those of you who are familiar with American history know about Alexis de Tocqueville, who visited the country in the early part of the 19th century and wrote that America was an exceptional nation because of the way that everybody could get started here without being held back by their social status or their ancestry. So this, you know, for years and years, this sort of myth continued sort of in spite of evidence to the contrary. So in the late 19th century, we had the Chinese Exclusion Act passed, which basically barred immigration from many Asian countries. We had, in the end of the 19th century, a big immigration wave that increasingly brought in people from, well, in the beginning, most of our immigrants, as you know, came from Northern and Western Europe. By the end of the 19th century, an increasing number were coming from Southern and Eastern Europe. And that actually alarmed a lot of American nationalists who sort of regarded the U.S. identity as being really wrapped up in the Anglo-Saxon notion. And so there was something called the Immigration Restriction Movement that surfaced in the late 19th century, which is really intended to maintain America's white, northern, Western European character and really limit the number of immigrants coming, not merely from Asia or Africa or the Middle East, but even from Southern and Eastern Europe. And so the outgrowth, the final product, and those of you who have studied immigration history, I'm sure know this very well, the product of that sentiment, that movement, was the passage in 1924 of national origin quotas, where immigrant visas were allocated according to your national origin, with the deliberate intent to maintain America's identity as a white Northern European nation. So, for example, something like 50,000 immigrant visas were reserved each year for anybody coming from Germany with a German national origin. Pretty much the same number for people from the British Isles. My grandparents, and I tell the story of my grandfather coming to this country, came from Norway around that time. He and any other immigrants from Scandinavian countries were also blessed, had the fortune of very high immigrant quotas. Whereas for each country in Africa and each country in Asia, the quota was about 100 visas. So it was, and it was explicit in the debate around the passage of this law. You know, the aim was made explicit that immigrants of color, essentially, immigrants from Asia and Africa and the Middle East, did not fit in with our notion of what America was all about and would not assimilate, would not be true to American values being very much synonymous with our Northern European background. And those national origin quotas were then reaffirmed in 1952 with the McCarran-Walter Act and continued to characterize, define our immigration policy in this country all the way up to the mid-1960s. Now, what happened in the mid-1960s? Well, as you know, we had the Civil Rights Movement that really came into full bloom. And we had a new president in 1964, Lyndon Johnson, who was committed to extending sort of the idealism of John Kennedy. And most important, in 1964, in the fall of 1964, we had an election that brought huge Democratic majorities to the US Congress. So we had a civil rights movement. We had very broad support in Congress for civil rights legislation. And in 1964, we passed the Civil Rights Act. And in 1965, we passed the Fair Housing Act, the Voting Rights Act. And, you know, in my judgment, part of that sort of foundation of civil rights legislation was the 1965 Immigration Act, which was very much passed with the same spirit, the same idea that it was time once and for all to end discrimination in this country, not only on the basis of race, but on the basis of nationality and national origin. And the immigration laws of this country needed to come into the same spirit as civil rights laws. And so the Civil Rights Act was passed, the Immigration Act was passed in 1965. At the time, it actually got a higher percentage of Republican votes than Democratic votes, which is sort of seems hard to imagine now, but it was a very different country back then. The Democratic Party was still very much dominated by Southern Democrats. They were the same. They were the ones who opposed the civil rights legislation, and they were largely the basis of opposition to the Immigration Act as well. The Republican Party was a far more liberal party at that time than it is today, far more oriented to sort of the establishment and the East Coast. But Republicans were in very much a small minority. But it was a bipartisan legislation. That's the point. You had all the sort of the progressive Democrats and progressive Republicans, even moderate Republicans coming together, so it passed. And this once and for all did away with national origin quotas. Basically, every nationality in the United States was put in America, in the country, in the world, was put on a roughly equal basis. It wasn't quite just because basically every country had, I think, 20,000 visa quota of about 20,000. Now, that sort of disadvantaged the larger countries as opposed to the smaller countries, but it wasn't on the basis of national origin. So the premise of my book is that the passage of this act finally brought about this moment when America could actually live out the ideal that it had held up for itself for 200 years. And we would finally be able to sort of deal with the reality of this question that we had raised from the beginning, which is that to be an American does not depend on your nationality or where you come from, that it depends on your adherence to a set of ideas. You know, it's kind of an ideological definition of a national identity, something that we had held in theory, but it was only really in the last 50 years, and of course this act just had its 50th anniversary, it's only been in these last 50 years that we've actually been able to sort of see the extent to which that's true, how does it work out? And so to me, the 1965 Immigration Act is the most important law passed in the 20th century with respect to America's character and identity. I'll be honest, I've been a journalist for many years. Most of this time was focused on international issues, so maybe that's my excuse. But when I heard from my agent, to tell you the truth, that we were coming up on the 50th anniversary of the 65 Immigration Act, I didn't know about it. I couldn't have told you what that law meant. It's one of the most unrecognized pieces of legislation in the United States that had tremendous, momentous importance. And it was really only after I began to explore it that I came to realize how important it was. And as I say, I now think this is absolutely key to understanding what America has become, what America is today. And only now are we really able to talk with some sophistication and knowledge and experience about what is the American identity? What does it mean to become America? And that's largely what my book is about. There are sort of two stories in my book. One is the story of the passage of this law, the history of immigration policy, what it took to get this law passed, the debate around it, and then the other part of the book, which is the majority of the book, is what has it meant in practice. And as I say, I focus on Fairfax County and four or five families in particular, which I'll get to in a minute. But just to give you an idea of the impact of the passage of this act, I got just a couple of graphs. First of all, this one shows the percentage of the U.S. population born outside the United States. And you see around 1910, when we had the, right before the passage of the national origin quotas, when we really were being inundated by immigrants, more than a million a year. And so in about 1910, it was like around 15% of the U.S. population was born outside the United States. Then it started going down, largely because of our restrictive immigration policy. And then you see this very, very dramatic turnabout. And where does it come? It comes right around, you know, 1970. Of course, these are centennial census figures, so you only get every 10 years. But you first see that sort of leveling off and then starting going up again in that 1960s-70 period. So, you know, this, and we're now not quite back up to where we were at the beginning of the 20th century, but we're definitely headed in that direction. And Census Bureau projections say that by the time the next U.S. president, who is elected in 2016, if he or she serves two full terms in office, by the time they leave office, we will be at above that 1910 figure. We will be at a record high in terms of the percentage of the American population that's born outside the country, the immigrant population. So this is important, but this is actually not the most important data point. The most important data point is this one. And this shows where are the immigrants coming from. And I just sort of simplified this to kind of make my point more clear. The blue bars are immigrants coming from Europe. So in 1910, you see close to 90% of all immigrants were coming from Europe. It started going down gradually, but when did you really see a change? You saw a change, and it's the same turning point that you saw in the previous slide, right around here. Look at that sharp drop-off from 1960 to 1980, and meanwhile, from 1960 to 1980, the sharp increase in immigrants coming from outside Europe, to the point that today, and this is as of 2010, and it's even greater now, about 90%, about 9 out of 10 immigrants to the United States today are coming from outside Europe. from Asia, Africa, the Middle East, and so forth. So these two slides really show in data how important the passage of that 65 Act was. Now, one of the things that's interesting to me is that both of these transformations were largely unintentional. The 1965 Immigration Act was passed sort of for, you might call, moral reasons or ideological reasons. It was passed, it was seen, the U.S. immigration policy was seen as discriminatory, so we wanted to sort of change the law to bring it into conformity, as I say, with our civil rights ideals. But nobody really had any idea that it was going to have the effect that it had. In fact, it was sort of just seen as correcting a wrong in our policy, in our laws. And the best way to understand how unintentional this was is to delve a little bit into the debate around the law. When President Johnson announced in his State of the Union message in 1964 that he was in January, well, it would have been January 65. It was January 64, sorry. That he was going to push for this immigration reform, he said, we can ask in this country of a prospective immigrant, what can you do for America? We should not be asking in what country were you born. So that was the idea, that immigrants would henceforth be judged not on the basis of the nationality, but on the basis of the contribution that they could potentially make to the United States. And priority in the legislative language was to be given to those immigrants who have skills that are considered, skills in education, training, that are considered, quote, especially advantageous to the United States. That was the idea, that was the language of the original Immigration Act. Now, the main opposition to this immigration reform, as I say, came from conservatives. And the chairman of the House Immigration Subcommittee was a guy by the name of Michael Feehan from Cleveland, Ohio. And he was very much allied with the lobby groups that wanted to maintain the national origin quotas, that wanted to maintain an immigration policy that favored Northern and Western Europe. Primary among them was the American Legion, but there were some other largely right-wing groups. He was aligned with them. And he refused even to consider this legislation. As chairman of the Immigration Subcommittee, he had that power. He refused to hold hearings on it or anything else. Well, then came the election in the fall of 64. He very nearly lost his seat. Lyndon Johnson intervened and went to Cleveland and campaigned for him. And so he won his reelection, but he owed a big debt to Lyndon Johnson. And Johnson made it clear that in return, he expected him to move this bill forward. Feehan agreed to do that, but he insisted on one important change. He wanted the language changed to favor not those immigrants who had skills that were especially advantageous to the United States, but instead to favor those immigrants who had relatives already living here. That was the origin of the family unification system. And the idea was that if you favored immigrants, and remember, in 1960 you had still three-fourths of all new immigrants were coming from Europe. So he figured that if you favored those immigrants who had relatives here, you would accomplish the same thing that the national origins quotas had accomplished. You would be bringing in more of the same. In fact, he gave an interview to the American Legion magazine, which I dug up, and he convinced them completely that this was the case. And the American Legion wrote a magazine, publishers wrote an editorial in which they said that the family unification system would constitute, quote, a naturally operating national origin system. And the Asian groups, the groups that were representing Asian citizens were outraged. And they thought, after all these years, we have finally gotten rid of the national origin quotas. And due to this clever move by Michael Feehan, we're going to be just as disadvantaged as we ever were. So at the time the law was passed, nobody, not the supporters of the legislation and the people that support, as I say, the people who supported this, it was for them just a kind of a token idea that we're going to get rid of the national origin quotas. The national origin quotas were on their face discriminatory. We're going to accomplish our objective just by getting rid of them. They didn't really care what practical effect it would have and whether it would bring in people of color or not. They just wanted the change in the language. So nobody, not those who voted for the reform or those who opposed it initially, thought that it was really going to have much of an impact whatsoever. Well, what happened? What Michael Feehan and others and the supporters as well did not realize was that the world had really changed. There was no longer any great pressure to come to the United States from Europe. Europe, by the mid-1960s, was doing very well. The economy was progressing. There were jobs aplenty. And meanwhile, what was happening in the rest of the world? You had decolonization taking place. Africa was going through independent. It was going having a lot of independence movements. There was a lot of violent conflict in the non-European world, whether in Southeast Asia or in Africa. And one product of all that violence was the urge to move. You had increased opportunities to move through global communication and transportation networks that hadn't existed before. It became more practical, more viable. Migration became a viable option where it really hadn't before. So you had huge pressure to immigrate from what we called the third world countries and reduced pressure to immigrate to the United States from European countries. Well, we still had this issue of family unification. And what that meant was that in the beginning, in spite of the fact that there was all these pressures to come to the United States, it was still hard to get a visa because you had to have relatives here. But there were other ways that you could come. You could come as a student. You could maybe somebody, an employer could bring you in. There were, you know, a certain number of visas that were left for that were given independently of your relatives. And what happened was that slowly the family unification system actually kicked in favor of immigrants from non-European countries. So you had, I tell a story in my book, it's actually an example from here from Fairfax County, a Pakistani man who came here in 1968 with a job offer. He had been working for an American company in Pakistan, and that company had a job for him in the United States, brought him and his family over. Well, under the family unification system, about 80% of immigrant visas were set aside for immigrants who had adult brothers and sisters who they could bring in, plus their spouses and their spouses' families. So this Pakistani man was able, within a few years, able to bring eight brothers and sisters, plus their spouses' brothers and sisters, and the brothers and sisters. So within 20 years, that one Pakistani man had single-handedly brought in 100 other people. And so the family unification system, instead of sort of holding down non-European immigration, actually exponentially expanded it. And now, as I say, 80% of all new visas coming into the country are by virtue of the family unification system. And that's the reason that you have so many people coming into the country now and why so many of them are coming from outside Europe. So that's the background to this. It was, a dramatic act, a momentous piece of legislation whose impact no one anticipated, which makes it, to me, as a journalist, all the more fascinating a story. So this is what I learned when I began investigating that. And then, as I say, I wanted to explore what this meant in practice. I was just telling Jim before class that I did not, in sort of exploring this, I didn't want to just kind of go for the immigrant success stories, of which there's many. You know, somebody arrives, you know, with nothing and gets a job delivering pizzas and within 10 years is a big real estate developer or something. I wasn't interested in that. I was really interested in what is the experience of people coming to this country. And as I say, what happens to people when they come to America? What does it mean to become American? How are they changed by coming to America? And just as important, how is America changed by all of a sudden having such a huge immigrant population coming from non-traditional areas? Because it really does sort of force us to think a lot more carefully about what this American identity is. Because one of the things that I found, and there was a guy, Seymour Martin Lipset, who used to teach here, right? Yeah. I don't know. I mean, you're all too young to have known him, but I'm sure you knew him, Jim. I mean, he wrote about American exceptionalism and really tried to define what American exceptionalism mean. And he defined it really in ideological terms. I think he had five sort of elements, individualism, egalitarianism, Can you recite?
I can't remember them all.
Anyway, there are five sort of elements of the American identity. But the problem, this didn't really sort of answer the question, because a lot of those ideological elements were really associated still with European values. So you had to think a lot more carefully about, well, really, what does it mean to become an American? What is the American identity? So these were the issues, these were the questions that I wanted to answer. I was, to tell you the truth, I was a little bit less interested in the economic impact of immigration. That's a really important one. I touch on that in my book. I was much more interested in the cultural and the identity issues that were associated with this. My own undergraduate degree was in anthropology. I'm now focusing, my new beat is what we call the belief beat. It's very much an idea beat. I've always been interested in issues of national identity. I spent a lot of time in the former Yugoslavia during the war in the former Yugoslavia, which was a war that was really fought around issues of identity. So this has always been my main interest. Those were the questions that I wanted to explore. So I spent quite a bit of time trying to identify some families whose experiences might help me understand this. It was a really difficult time. I took a year off from NPR to write this book. I spent more than the first 6 months, probably 7 or 8 months spent trying to find the right families to tell the story. It was really hard, because those of you who have immigrant backgrounds know that immigration, coming to a country, can be a traumatic experience. There's a lot of pain, there's family issues that often come up as part of the immigration experience. There's a sense of loss, you know, you're leaving your homeland. I mean, this is painful, and I found many immigrant families whose stories were fascinating and rich and didn't want to share them, didn't want to relive that, didn't want to go into that. Maybe they felt that their positions were, they had worked so hard to get some security and stability in this country, they didn't want to do anything to risk what they had. Some of them just were very busy and just, you know, didn't have the time, because when you agree to be the subject of the kind of research that I'm doing, you're committing to hours and hours and hours of being interviewed with me, coming to into your living room and asking really a lot of personal questions, not only of you, but of your extended family. So it's a big commitment. And also, as I say, I wanted to find families whose stories really highlighted these issues of acculturation or integration, whatever you want to call it. And you know, that would enable me to really tell this story with some depth and richness. But finally I did. And I'm going to just mention sort of in closing here before we do questions that I really focused primarily on, and I did an NPR series out of this research as well. And in the NPR series, I really focus on four families in particular. One is a family from Bolivia. One is a family from Korea. One is a family from Libya. And the other is a family from El Salvador. And I sort of, with each of these families, I sort of wanted to explore, as I say, what their America meant to them. And it was really, what I found was that America meant something different to each of them. There wasn't some sort of simplistic answer that explained the sort of the immigration perspective of all these families. First of all, the family from Bolivia, which I think is a typical one, moved here in the mid-1980s. In all of these cases, it was about family unification. So a Bolivian man came here, got a job as a dentist, married a Bolivian girl. She came, became a citizen, and then she was able to bring her sisters and their husbands to this country. So I focused on this Bolivian family, and a guy in particular named Victor Alarcón, whose wife's sister was the sister of the was the wife of the dentist who got a job here. And they left Bolivia in the mid-1980s. At a time of hyperinflation in Bolivia, and he talked about having to stand in line, get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and stand in line for bread or milk or whatever. I mean, they were just driven by economic need to come here. And he came, his two brothers did not come. And in that particular that particular point is really important because I found that immigration itself is a self-selecting phenomenon. I mean, you're talking about those people who are willing to take the risk of leaving their homeland and coming to another country without the promise of a job, not speaking the language. It appeals to the least risk-averse elements of a population, and also the most, the bravest, the most experimental, the most adventurous, the most enterprising. He fit that bill completely. I mean, he was the only one in his family and who was really willing to do that. And when he came here, he really lived that out. I mean, he started out working as a dishwasher on an overnight, you know, shift in a Mexican restaurant, and lived with his sister and her husband, you know, in the basement of their apartment, walked to work, and, you know, just gradually was able to sort of get ahead. And what I found most fascinating and most endearing about him is he was really epitomized the sort of the self-taught individual. He wanted to learn skills that would allow him to advance in the United States. And the one place that he went to do this was the Fairfax County Public Library. There were no public libraries in Bolivia, and he didn't really know even that much about how libraries work. But he knew that he was just very smart. And so he went to the Fairfax County Library, and he would take out books on car repair. He taught himself to be an auto mechanic by reading books in the Fairfax County Library. He taught himself computer skills by reading books. He would go with his family to the Fairfax Library every single night. In fact, he did it for a month before realizing that you could actually check books out. So he would go gather these books on his table, and he said, the finally librarian came around and said, you're taking the same books every night. Why don't you just take them home? And he didn't realize it before. But he learned all these skills, which he then was able to use to get better positions in society, better jobs. He taught himself, and he said to me, and this is in the NPR story, everything I know, I learned from a book. You can learn anything you need to know by reading a book. So this is kind of a classic. I mean, you know, he's not a successful man now. I mean, they're living very modestly. They own their own home, but it's a pretty modest home. So it's not as though he became some big industrialist, you know, but he and his family have really achieved a level of security in this country, and that's what America meant to him. America to him really, in classic terms, was a land of opportunity, you know, epitomized by the Fairfax County Public Library that really gave him the opportunity to do all these things. So it's a wonderful, librarians love this story because, you know, it sort of affirms the importance of libraries. I also focus on a woman who came here from El Salvador. None of these people were illegal. This is a really important sort of aspect of my story. I did not want to get into the whole issue of undocumented immigration, amnesty, all that stuff. I really focused exclusively on immigrants who came here legally, whose status was legal from the time they got here, and who became, every single one of these ultimately became a U.S. citizen. So that was really important. So she came here. She was a refugee from political violence. She had a terrible, sad backstory of what she went through in El Salvador. And she finally made it here, and she achieved, you know, she became a citizen. And the contrast for her was not an economic contrast from El Salvador. It was a contrast of safety. I mean, she grew up in a war zone where people around her were being killed all the time. She told me in the sort of the succinct quote that sort of summarizes her view of what America represented, that she can come home at night and lock the door and go into her apartment, and she can see her kids sleeping in bed safely. And she knows that no one is going to come in the night and break in. No one is going to come in at night and come and get her. I mean, so for her, America is equated with safety and security and refuge from the violence that she had known in El Salvador. I'm sure that that is also speaks for millions of other immigrants who have come from war-torn countries. Family from Korea, a very different story. And you may know Mark Keem. He's a delegate from Northern Virginia. He's the guy I focus on in this. He came to the United States again, through family unification. He and his family. He came here at the age of 16, and felt as a Korean high school student, kind of out of place, surrounded by white Anglo students. And it was actually by studying political science and American history that he sort of discovered the American identity, because he was reading, this stuff from the U.S. Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, and the idea that in America all men are created equal and you have equal rights. And so he absorbed the sort of, for him it was these things that Seymour Martin Lipset talks about, the ideological, even political notions of the American identity. And he became a big, his first activism, political activism, was with Jesse Jackson in 1988, the Rainbow Coalition. What he became enamored of America's political promise and the idea that he, as a Korean, could actually sort of embrace the idea of American democracy. And not surprisingly, he went into politics. He got a job on Capitol Hill. He was an aide to Senator Dick Durbin. And then ultimately, in 2008, he was one of the Fairfax County coordinators for the Obama campaign and ran for the Virginia delegate. The Assembly of Delegates, was elected as the first Asian American immigrant elected to the Virginia House of Delegates. So for him, America was a political idea, a place where these political ideas that I said were myth for much of the country, but by the time he came here, they were a reality. So he really is now a super patriot, in defense of American democracy and the American political ideology. The fourth person whose experience is really important in the current age is an immigrant from Libya. And he came here, his name is Issam Omish. I actually bring his story and Mark Keem's story together in the later parts of the book. I hate to kind of give away a punchline, but I'll do it. He ultimately ran against Mark Keem. He was Mark Keem's Democratic primary opponent, first time Mark Keem ran for Virginia House of Delegates. So that's kind of, their stories come together in this beautiful way, but that's later on. So Issam comes here as a 16-year-old, comes from Libya. His father actually was working for the IMF when they first came, very well educated and very secular. His mother did not cover back in Libya. His father was not highly religious. But they came here. Issam didn't speak a word of English. He went to Jeb Stuart High School, which in the mid-1980s was the place to look at immigrants in the Fairfax County school system. Felt out of place, like many immigrants would. He didn't speak English very well. Really devoted himself to his studies. Was an unbelievably outstanding student. In spite of the fact that arriving as a freshman, not speaking English, he graduated at the top of his class just 3 years later on time, and went on to become, went to Georgetown University and became a physician, is now a very successful physician in Fairfax County. But he felt kind of out of it, same way that Mark Keem did. Mark Keem, when he was in high school, felt out of it and then sort of became integrated sort of by studying America's political history. Issam sort of discovered or rediscovered Islam in high school. And as I say, his parents weren't really devout, but he realized that the one thing that really distinguished him from his classmates was his religion. He was Muslim. They weren't secular. I mean, they did faster and Ramadan and so forth. So, I mean, he was Muslim. And the Darul Hijra Mosque was getting established just about the time that Issam came here. And he and his brother started going to the mosque and meeting with other Muslims, and their people spoke Arabic, and he kind of got in touch with Islam here. And what's remarkable about this, and what this has to say about America, is that he actually credits America with his discovery of Islam, because he found that at every step of his sort of enlightenment, he found support for his getting in touch with his Islam. His high school principal at Jeb Stuart High School allowed him, encouraged him and a couple of his Muslim classmates to establish a prayer room and released them every Friday afternoon for prayers or other days as well. He goes on to Georgetown, a Jesuit school, and one of the Catholic chaplains at Georgetown encouraged him to sort of further his studies in Islam, which is kind of a remarkable thing in itself, and was sort of a faculty sponsor for ISAM establishing a Muslim Students Association at Georgetown. He was the founder of the Muslim Students Association at Georgetown. And what he told me is that if he had stayed in Libya, he probably never would have become a devout Muslim, because there it's just kind of taken for granted and nobody really thinks about Islam. I mean, it's just kind of there. If he had gone anywhere else in Europe, it wouldn't have happened. He felt that it was only in America, with its tradition of religious freedom, that he actually found support for becoming a devout Muslim. And it's kind of ironic, particularly in light of what's happening today. We're talking the 1980s and early 1990s now, a very different country. But, I mean, he became sort of a patriot, an American patriot, because he felt that in America, the idea of religious freedom is actually real and was, at least in his experience, practiced and honored. And he, you know, cites these examples of key people in his adolescence who not only gave him permission to sort of become devout and a follower of Islam, but actually encouraged him and sort of facilitated it, even at a Catholic institution, Georgetown University. So he, you know, really is a firm believer that America actually does now embody these ideas that it had sort of not recognized for so long. Now, you know, it's obviously become a lot more difficult in recent years, but so for Issam Omish, the idea of being American, the idea of America is religious freedom. So you've got four stories here, you know, economic opportunity, safety, sort of politics, religion, that different aspects of the American reality, each of which appealed to this immigrant family. So, you know, in conclusion, actually, my book is a very positive book. I mean, it basically says that even though this legislation, 1965, didn't have as its intent to transform America, it actually did. And not only that as a result of the changes that have taken place in the last 50 years, America has sort of proved its resilience, it's proved its capacity to integrate people from different backgrounds. The American national identity, I would argue, is not actually weakened, it's actually strengthened, because we now actually are able to understand it in its reality and not just in theory. So, you know, in that sense, it's a very positive book. Now, what's happened in the last year or two, I think, really challenges a lot of that. And sadly, I have seen this before. You know, when countries go through periods of stress, it becomes very tempting to kind of blame the other. And we've seen a resurgence in the last couple of years of this kind of populist nationalism that I saw in the former Yugoslavia in the early 1990s, that we've seen it in Africa, we've seen it in Europe. I mean, this is kind of a universal thing. And that kind of, in a way, tarnishes the story that I've been telling. It kind of taints it. But, you know, I do think that America has kind of mastered, it did pass this test, in a sense. And Fairfax County, in particular, passed this test. You know, there was a story in the Washington Post just a couple of weeks ago about how Fairfax County has fallen on really hard times. And I don't question any of that. But the truth is that whether you look at the school system, whether you look at law enforcement, whether you look at governance in Fairfax County, Fairfax County, I didn't mention this before, in 1970, Fairfax County was like 0.3% immigrant. And it's now about 30%. 3 out of 10 residents of Fairfax County born outside the United States. I mean, very few places in the United States have gone through a kind of an immigrant influx like this. And the other thing I point out is this is only one of the transformations that Fairfax County has gone through in the last 50 years. At first, it went through desegregation. Fairfax County was an entirely segregated southern county. You know, not only were the schools segregated, the neighborhoods were segregated. And so desegregation is a very traumatic thing for a community to go through. And Fairfax County went through that. And at the same time, it went through urbanization, another destabilizing experience for a county. I mean, Fairfax County in 1960 was a rural county. It is now part of the D.C. metropolitan area with well over a million residents. And, you know, you all know how Fairfax County has changed sort of in terms of urbanization. And then it goes through this immigrant influx. So you've got three major transformations, each of which is destabilizing for a community. And they came in very quick succession. And, you know, I, as a result of my research, I actually felt that Fairfax County authorities have done a pretty decent job of dealing with these stresses. You know, I profile in my book a Fairfax County police officer whose career as a police officer, she was deputy police chief at Fairfax County at a time, really sort of spanned these various changes. And to me, she sort of had a very enlightened attitude. I'm sure it's like not consistent across the entire police force, but you know, there were leaders in the Fairfax County Police Department that really did understand and were sensitive to what was going on. I think the school system, I mean, the Fairfax County schools have gone through, as I say, desegregation, growth, and immigrant influx. One out of six students in Fairfax County schools right now requires English language instruction. That takes a lot of resources. It takes a lot of attention for a school. And the fact that Fairfax students do as well as they do, in spite of this huge burden that has been put on the school system as a result of immigration, is a real tribute, I think, to the school system. And governance. I mean, this is, you know, this is a real challenge for countries. And it's not just a matter of privileged white people sort of resenting immigrants of color. In fact, there are competitions between communities. When immigrants moved into Fairfax County, they sought out the neighborhoods that had the lowest cost housing. In many cases, those were African-American neighborhoods. And those African-American neighborhoods, because they had come through desegregation, basically everything that they got, everything that they had to fight for. I tell a story of the Bailey's community down around Bailey's Crossroad, where they got utilities, they got street improvements, they got a community center, they got schools, only by organizing and fighting for them and winning them. And no sooner had they gotten those achievements than all of a sudden immigrants started coming in, and then they didn't have the same sense of civic obligation. You know, they didn't necessarily show up for, you know, the clean up the park days. They showed up for the community picnics, but they didn't show up for the work days. And there was a lot, and they were over, a lot of them lived in over, a lot of them moved in with relatives, and you know, so you had overcrowded housing. And so there were serious tensions between the African-American community and the immigrant community. So the, you know, if you just took a look at something like zoning, you know, really difficult challenges for authorities to face. So whether it's law enforcement, whether it's schooling, whether it's governance, the Fairfax County authorities have had a lot to deal with, a lot of stresses to deal with in recent years. And as I say, I think they've done pretty well. So that's the story. You know, I took a year off to write it. I think it's, as I say, largely a good news story. I'm afraid there's a coda to it now that, you know, I can't quite anticipate. You know, we can only hope that this is kind of a momentary blip, this kind of populist nationalism that we're seeing. But, you know, I remain hopeful, I guess. So I haven't left much time for questions.